Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome to Umar Radio. You are listening to the Aqeedah class with myself, Abu Musab. Last time we had stopped, we were still busy doing classes from Al-Aqeedah to Al-Tahawiyyah of Imam Al-Tahawi rahimahullah. We had last stopped on the book that in the copy that we are using on page number 5. For those of you who are new basically to the class, you can download the kitab on Ummah Forum. There's the Aqeedah thread which you can find in the Ummah Radio section, and in there is a download link to the kitab, so if you want to follow along you can follow over there. Alternatively, you can listen just in via the audio, there's no problem either way. Additionally, if you have any questions regarding anything about the class, you can ask your questions via Skype, the Skype name being Ummah Radio. Okay, so last time we had done till the end of page 4 of this particular print of Al-Aqeedah Al-Tahawiyyah. So we will continue on from here insha'Allah. This is page number 5 and point number 24 of this particular book where they have set it out in this manner. So in any case, to continue, he says, يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَى وَيَعْصِمُ وَيُعَافِي فَضْلًا. He says, still continuing speaking about Allah, and he says, يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَى, Allah guides whomsoever He wishes. وَيَعْصِمُ وَيُعَافِي فَضْلًا, that Allah protects and Allah grants safety, and when Allah does good to a person, then it is فَضْلًا, it's out of the grace of Allah. Allah is under no obligation to do anything for anybody. So if Allah does something good for you, forgives you, protects you, safeguards you and everything, then this is done from the grace of Allah and not because you or I deserve it. Then he says, وَيُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَى, and Allah leads astray whomsoever He wishes. وَيَخْذِلُ وَيَبْتَلِي عَدْلًا, and Allah disgraces and tries and tests people out of His justice. So when Allah causes any calamity, any difficulty to befall you, or when Allah causes any harm to befall a particular person, or any disgrace or anything which comes down upon a person, then this is the adla, then this is the justice of Allah, that when Allah does something, Allah always does so with a just reason. Allah never oppresses anybody. So if you find some difficulty befalls you, فَمِن نَفْسِكَ, then it's because you have earned it yourself and Allah is now just meeting out justice to you. It's not as though, like how some people seem to think, Allah is unjust. When أعوذ بالله من ذلك, no, Allah is just. And when Allah does good for us, then it's the grace of Allah that Allah does these things for us, because in reality we don't deserve it. And when we get punished or undergo a difficulty, then this is actually what we deserve, and Allah is just meting out simple justice towards us. So this is what he is saying in this particular point here. Then he says, وَكُلُّهُمْ يَتَقَلَّبُونَ فِي مَشِيئَتِهِ بَيْنَ فَضْلِهِ وَعَدْلِهِ. All of creation, or in this case here we'd be referring to especially to man and jinn, but basically it's the entire creation. He says, يَتَقَلَّبُونَ فِي مَشِيئَتِهِ بَيْنَ فَضْلِهِ وَعَدْلِهِ, that you are wavering between the wavering between the grace and the justice of Allah. This is with regards to the will of Allah. So depending on the will of Allah, whether Allah has do good to you through Allah's grace, or Allah allows some harm to befall you, it's through the justice of Allah. So everybody with regards to the will of Allah, he finds himself in one of these two categories, either in the category where the grace of Allah is upon you, or the category where Allah simply meets out the justice that you are deserving for your own self. He then says, وَهُوَ مُتَعَالٍ عَنِ الْأَضْدَادِ وَالْأَنْدَادِ, and Allah is free and above, beyond having any opponents or any rivals. There's nobody who can oppose Allah, who can act as a partner or as a rival, that if Allah says A, then somebody else wants to come along and say no, do B, or it should be B, anything like this. Nothing of the sort. Allah is far removed from any of these sort of things. Then he says, La rada li qada'ihi. There is no one who can turn back the decree of Allah. That when Allah has decreed something, then there's nobody who can prevent it. That when Allah decrees anything, be it good or be it bad, when Allah decrees something to take place, then there is nobody or no thing or anything in existence which can turn back and repel the decree of Allah. Then he says, وَلَا مُعَقِّبَ لِحُكْمِهِ. Very similar meaning. He says, there is no one who can, as you can say, have the مُعَقِّب, تَعَقِّب, basically to have the final word, or in other cases it's also mean that can repel the, it's a very similar meaning to say that no, there is no one who can repel the command of Allah. It's another way of saying it is also that when Allah puts down a command that such and such a thing will take place, then there is nobody who can now come afterwards and put a new command down and say that no, this, I'm having the final say on the matter and this year is going to take place. The final say, the only say basically, is with Allah alone and nobody else has a say in the matter. And then he says, وَلَا غَالِبَ لِأَمْرِهِ. And there is no one that can overpower his affairs. So when Allah says or does anything, then there is nobody, no angel, no jinn, no human, no creature, no nothing of the sort which can overpower Allah in any matter. So وَلَا غَالِبَ لِأَمْرِهِ. Like Allah says, وَاللَّهُ غَالِبٌ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. As Allah mentions in the Quran, that Allah is all-powerful and overwhelming upon His affairs, but most of the people don't know this. So there is nobody who can overpower Allah on anything. When Allah says, this is what will take place, there's nobody who can overpower Allah and try and say no, that this can't take place, or I won't allow this to take place. Nothing of the sort. Then he says, آمَنَّا بِذَٰلِكَ كُلَّهُ وَأَيْقَنَّا أَنَّ كُلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِهِ. We believe in all of this. Everything which has been mentioned now previously by Imam At-Tahawi rahimahullah, we believe in every single last one of this. وَأَيْقَنَّا أَنَّ كُلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِهِ. And we have yaqeen, we have this firm conviction that everything is from the side of Allah. So then he continues on and he says, وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَبْدُهُ الْمُصْطَفَى وَنَبِيُّهُ الْمُجْتَبَى وَرَسُولُهُ الْمُرْتَضَى. He says that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is the slave, his chosen slave, wa nabiyyuhu al-mujtaba, and his elected prophet, wa rasuluhu al-murtada, and his messenger that he is pleased with. Then he says, وَإِنَّهُ خَاتَمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَإِمَامُ الْأَتْقِيَاءِ وَسَيِّدُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَحَبِيبُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. He says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is خَاتَمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ, the last and the final messenger of Allah. That there is nobody else who will come as a messenger anymore. Rather, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the seal, and no one else will come anymore after this. And he says, وَإِمَامُ الْأَتْقِيَاءِ, and the leader of all the pious people. So there is nobody who can be more pious than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the imam of the muttaqeen, the leader of all the people who have piety. وَسَيِّدُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, and the chief of all the prophets, the chief of all the messengers. And وحبيب رب العالمين, and the beloved of the Lord of the worlds. Then he continues, he says, وكل دعوة دعوة نبوة بعد بعد نبوته فغي وهوى. He says, every claim of prophethood after his prophethood, then it is, as you can say, it is misguidance and pure opinion, people following their nafs, but there is no basis, no anything that anybody can come out and say that, like Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadian Kafir, that he comes along and he claims to be a Nabi, or Rashad Khalifa, or all these other kuffar. Anybody who comes along and claims to be a Nabi, then he is, apart from him actually being a kafir, it's pure, outright falsehood, misguidance, following of their personal base desires, but there's no no basis to it whatsoever. Then he says, وهو المبعوث إلى عامة الجن وكافة الورى بالحق والهدى وبالنور والضياء. He says that he is the one who was sent to all of jinn. And وكافة الورى, ورى here is being referred to mankind. So all of the jinn and all of mankind as well. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Sayyidul Kawnain, how does the line from Qasida Burda go now? The line, I can't remember it right now at this particular moment, but Thaqalain refers to mankind and jinn, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sent both to mankind and to jinn as well. So he is the one who has been sent to all the jinn and all of mankind with the truth and the guidance and with the light and illumination. So obviously that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has been sent with the perfect, as you can say, perfect guidance and obviously there is guidance mentioned here, but the light and the illumination here is also further referring to, as you can say, the Quran and Islam, and all of this is the additional guidance which has been referred to in this particular, with this particular words here. And now he moves on to the next chapter. This first started out speaking about Allah, then he moved on to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and now he's moving on to the Quran. So he says, وَإِنَّ الْقُرْآنَ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ مِنْهُ بَدَأَ بِلَا كَيْفِيَّةٍ قَوْلًا. That indeed the Quran, it is the speech of Allah. مِنْهُ بَدَأَ بِلَا كَيْفِيَّةٍ. That it came from Allah, as you can say, it originated from Allah without bila kayfiyya, without any howness. We don't attribute a howness, that how did it come from Allah and all these sort of things. We don't attribute this how to anything. We just accept it because it came from Allah, and that's all that matters. We don't go in with voices and sounds and letters and all those sort of things. We don't go into any of that. We say that it is the speech of Allah, and that is what we accept. We don't go into explaining how exactly it is. So he then continues on and he says, وَأَنزَلَهُ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ وَحْيًا. He revealed it, that Allah sent down the Quran upon his messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the form of wahi, divine revelation. وصدقه المؤمنون على ذلك حقا. And the believers, they believed truly in this, they truly believed in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. وأيقنوا أنه كلام الله تعالى بالحقيقة ليس بمخلوق ككلام البرية. And they had this firm belief and conviction that it is the speech of Allah Ta'ala in reality, and it is not created like how the rest of the speech of creation is. So the Quran is the uncreated word of Allah. And this was a very big issue in the time of the Mu'tazila, what the Khawarij and the Mu'tazila, the deviant sects which had started up in early Islam. The Mu'tazila, them, they held this belief that the Quran is created. And Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, Imam Ahli Sunnah, Imam Ahmad, he became so famous as a result of this, his steadfastness on this particular point, that when the Mu'tazila, they were the rulers at the time, they tried to get everybody to follow their deviant belief of the Quran being created, and Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he stood steadfast and firm and refused to budge one inch for these people. So alhamdulillah, as a result of the effort of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, today we can sit and our aqidah is intact, and we did not get affected by the deviant belief of the beliefs of the Mu'tazila. Otherwise today we could have been holding the same belief that the Quran is created. So in any case, that he mentioned that the Quran is the uncreated word of Allah, and it is not like the speech of the rest of mankind. فَمَنْ سَمِعَهُ فَزَعَمَ أَنَّهُ كَلَامُ الْبَشَرِ فَقَدْ كَفَرَ. Yeah, he makes a very strong statement. He says, whoever hears the Quran and he claims that it is the speech of mankind, فَقَدْ كَفَرَ, then he has become a kafir. So anybody who hears, it does not matter what ayah it is, whether it's one small piece or a whole piece or a surah or anything. And this is something which you find happening in today's times amongst, okay, these people are kafir, although they claim to be Muslim. You have like the Quran only people, and those who follow the number 19 theory, where they had to reject two ayat of the Quran. And you have other people who reject one, two things which come in the Quran and say, no, this is not acceptable, or this is what's inserted by people and things like this. As the Imam Tahawi rahimahullah, he says in no uncertain terms, فَقَدْ كَفَرْ, then such a person has become a kafir. There's no two ways about it. There's nothing to think about or to ask about or to discuss. Such a person has become a kafir instantly, and there's no debate on the topic. Then he says, وَقَدْ ذَمَّهُ اللَّهُ وَعَابَهُ وَأَوْعَدَهُ بِسَقَرْ حَيْثُ قَالَ تَعَالَى سَأُصْلِيهِ سَقَرْ فَلَمَّا أَوْعَدَ اللَّهُ بِسَقَرْ لِمَنْ قَالَ إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ عَلِمْنَا وَأَيْقَنَّا أَنَّهُ قَوْلٌ خَالِقُ الْبَشَرِ وَلَا يُشْبِهُ قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ. You know, apart from the importance of Aqidah al-Tahawiyah itself, Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah, he wrote this kitab in such a manner, despite the conciseness of the kitab and the depth of the meaning as well. An additional feature is that the kitab rhymes. If you see how he has broken it down, everything rhymes. He says, so in any case, he says here now, regarding a person who claims that the Quran is from the speech of mankind, such a person becomes a kafir, and Allah has censured and blamed and warned such a person of saqar. And saqar is a particular level in Jahannam where such people will go to. The basis for this is where Allah said, سَأُصْلِيهِ saqar, I will put him in saqar. So when Allah Ta'ala promised a person saqar, he says, لِمَنْ قَالَ إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ, Allah promised this command for such this threat. Allah issued this threat against such people who make the statement and says that the Quran, إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ, indeed this is just the speech of mankind. So Imam Tahawi rahimahullah, he says, we come to know and we have the firm conviction that it is the speech of Khaliqul Bashar, the creator of mankind. وَلَا يُشْبِهُ قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ, and it does not resemble the speech of the creation whatsoever. And now here is another very important point. He says, وَمَنْ وَصَفَ اللَّهَ بِمَعْنًا مِّن مَعَانِ الْبَشَرِ فَقَدْ كَفَرْ. That whomsoever attributes or describes Allah with such a quality, such a meaning, which is not, as you can say, from the characteristics of human beings, then such a person has committed kufr. So today, too often this takes place, when you find this is unfortunate, found so often amongst Muslims, especially amongst these chain mails and all these sort of things. It's full up on forums, on Facebook, on even Twitter and all these sort of places. People find these Christian stories, kufr, and these people, being ignorant as they are, they simply take Jesus out, and all these 10-15 places in the story, they just replace Jesus with Allah, and therefore it's taking, like taking excreta from the toilet and putting a cherry on top and calling it a cake. It doesn't make it a cake, no matter how and what you try to do. It's excreta, and that's all it is, excreta with a cherry on top. So in like manner, when you take these stories of kufr and you now just take out Hanuman, or you take out Krishna, or you take out Jesus, and you put Allah or God in its place there, it does not make it Islamic whatsoever. Many a times I read these stories, and the stories are pure kufr, which is sufficient to expel a person from the fold of Islam, whoever holds such a belief. But so many people are ignorant, and they do not even realize it. So in these stories you find this, where Allah is described as being, having human characteristics and qualities, which is what the Christians believe. They believe that God is a man walking around in heaven, an old man walking around in heaven with a long beard, and he sits on a chair and all these sort of things here. This is their belief. Now people take these same stories, God laughing there, playing with angels and all these sort of things. All of this is kufr, and it will put a person outside the fold of Islam, regardless of whether you intended it or not. Your intention means nothing. You have committed kufr and you leave Islam. You then have to repent to get back into the fold of Islam. So it's a very serious matter that people need to understand and pay attention to it, and not take the deen as a joke where everybody goes left, right and center playing around with the deen. And inshallah, on another point, another time, at another stage in time, we can discuss the issue of takfir, and especially that issue on what puts a person outside the fold of Islam. Inshallah, we can have a separate class just for that issue, because it is a very important issue. Just recently, just a quick off topic. Recently, somebody sent a video which goes around, does the rounds from YouTube and all these WhatsApp and everything. A person is standing and he's performing salah there. These are joke videos. He's standing and performing salah, and a man comes up and taps him on the shoulder, and he does a flip over backwards, and he lands in the saf next to this person and continues on with his salah like this. And then you have other ones where a man goes into sajda, and then this one come and he tap on him, and then he gets up and he meets him like this, and all these other sort of things where the people mock and play with salah. And this is something which Allah explains in no uncertain terms in the Quran, wherein Allah had declared that لا تعتذروا قد كفرتم بعد إيمانكم, wherein Allah said, don't make excuses, you have committed kufr after having believed. So it's a very, 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 very serious issue. Many people, and in fact, one of the shuyukh, I remember him writing this in last year on WhatsApp, as a matter of fact, in one of his WhatsApp groups, he was saying that too many times you find people committing kufr without even realizing it, where they send around these jokes. In fact, Mufti Ismail Menk himself, he also alluded to to this as well, where he said that you find people, they send out jokes about heaven and hell and angels and this and that, and it's become such a norm that nobody thinks twice about it. Yet all of this is kufr akbar, kufr which puts a person outside the fold of Islam, because Allah said, قُلْ أَبِاللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ, that it ayah starts, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ لَيَنْقُولُنَّ إِنَّمَا كُنَّا نَخُوضُ وَنَلَعَبُ. If you were to ask them, they will say, we were just playing and joking, we weren't intending to mock. And that's what many people say today. We were just joking around, you know, we weren't trying to mock Islam. Referring as well to this video I was mentioning now earlier, this person somersaulting backwards and into the next stuff. The people who made it, they say, no, we don't intend to mock Islam. But your intention of whether you wanted to mock or not is of no consequence. Allah says, قُلْ أَبِاللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Say, was it Allah and His signs and His messenger that you were mocking? That you were joking around about. La ta'atadhiru. Allah says it clear. Do not make excuses. قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ. You have committed kufr, disbelief, after having iman. Showing clear that it is Kufr Akbar, which expels a person from the fold of Islam. So it's a very, very, very serious matter. So for in future, just by the way, anybody who is sending out jokes or all these sort of things, make certain that if before you send, click send or broadcast or anything, read the joke yourself. Otherwise, don't send it across. If you find it contains Kufr and you spread it, you will be part of those people who fall into kufr as well. So it's a very serious issue, and people need to realize just how important it is. But in any case, coming back to the kitab here, he says, whoever describes and attributes Allah a quality from the qualities of human beings, then such a person has committed kufr. Then he says, فَمَنْ أَبْصَرَ هَذَا اِعْتَبَرْ وَعَنْ مِثْلِ قَوْلِ الْكُفَّارِ إِنْ زَجَرْ. He says that whoever sees this, فَمَنْ أَبْصَرَ هَذَا اِعْتَبَرْ, whoever sees this, take lesson and abstain from making statements similar to that. وَعَنْ مِثْلِ قَوْلِ الْكُفَّارِ إِنْ زَجَرْ, avoid and refrain from making statements similar to that of the kuffar. So it's a very important point. Avoid this, all these statements and jokes and things and Islamized Christian stories. All these things, people like to take it out for some sort of morals and things like this. God, Allah whispered to somebody this and things like this. And then people say, MashaAllah, MashaAllah, SubhanAllah, and all these sort of things here. Not realizing the severity of the case and the issue that they are dealing with. That they play and mock and end up in kufr, and they don't even realize quite how serious the issue is. So he says, you see this, take lesson and refrain and avoid making statements like that which the kuffar make. And he says, وَعَلِمَ أَنَّهُ بِصِفَاتِهِ لَيْسَ كَالْبَشَرِ, and know that Allah in His attributes and qualities, لَيْسَ كَالْبَشَرِ, that Allah is not like mankind, nor like any other creation of Allah for that matter. But yeah, in particular he's saying, لَيْسَ كَالْبَشَرِ, that Allah is not like His creation at all. Then he continues on. He says, وَالرُّؤْيَةُ حَقٌ لِأَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ بِغَيْرِ إِحَاطَةٍ وَلَا كَيْفِيَّةٍ كَمَا نَطَقَ بِهِ كِتَابُ رَبِّنَا وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاضِرَةٌ إِلَى رَبِّهَا نَاضِرَةٌ. He says, and the seeing of Allah by the people of Jannah is the truth. This is part of the belief of the Ahlul Sunnah that the people, the Muslims in Jannah, will see Allah بِأَعْيُنِ رُؤُوسِهِمْ, with their physical eyes. How Allah wishes it, Allahu A'lam. We don't go into any further details. He says, the vision that the people will see Allah, this for the people of Jannah, this is the truth, بِغَيْرِ إِحَاطَةٍ وَلَا كَيْفِيَّةٍ, without being able to encompass and to limit and restrict Allah with your sight. You know, we look at the sun, we are able to comprehend and limit and see the sun, that it's like this and this and this, it's yellow or it's orange or whatever color it may be, and it's this side here and all these sort of things. We have a kayfiyya, a howness, and we have the ability to encompass it. So he says that when we see Allah, it will not be like this. One, there will not be any, there is no kayfiyyah, we don't attribute or explain any howness to it. And two, there will not be a comprehension, an encompassment of Allah. Because obviously, there is no one or no thing which can fully comprehend and encompass Allah in His true form. So he says, that we believe in this, that the people of Jannah will see Allah without giving any howness or encompassment to it. He says, like how the book of our Lord, the Quran, has said, like Allah mentions in the Quran, وَجُوهُ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, that this is referring to on the day of Qiyamah, وَجُوهُ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ, on that day there will be some faces which are brightened, إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, looking at their Lord. So these are the believers, the Muslims, on the day of Qiyamah, the believers, their faces will be bright and they will be looking at Allah. So from the Quran itself, Allah mentions this ayah as the dalil that the people of Jannah will see Allah. He says, وَتَفْسِيرُهُ عَلَى مَا أَرَادَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَعَلِمَهُ. The explanation for how this will take place exactly, this is how Allah Ta'ala Himself intended it, Allah Ta'ala Himself knows. We don't know, we just affirm that which Allah has mentioned. We don't go any further than that. He says, وَكُلُّ مَا جَاءَ فِي ذَلِكَ مِنَ الْحَدِيثِ الصَّحِيحِ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَهُوَ كَمَا قَالَ وَمَعْنَاهُ عَلَى مَا أَرَادَ لَا نَدْخُلُ فِي ذَلِكَ مُتَأَوِّلِينَ بِآرَائِنَا وَلَا مُتَوَهِّمِينَ بِأَهْوَائِنَا. He says, everything which has come in the authentic hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam on this topic here, or on the sifat of Allah, that like Allah has a yad and a waj and all these other things mentioned in the hadith, with regards to all of this, he says, then it is how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said it, and the meaning is that which he sallallahu alaihi wasallam intended. We do not know it. He says, لا ندخل في ذلك متأولين بآرائنا. We don't enter into these things interpreting it with our personal opinions. ولا متوهمين بأهوائنا. Nor do we have any assumptions and assume and think that it is like this or like that, or assuming things with our personal opinion and our desires. So we don't go into it making up things with our desires, nor do we give it any interpretations based on our opinions. He says, فَإِنَّهُ مَا سَلِمَ فِي دِينِهِ إِلَّا مَنْ سَلِمَ لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَلِرَسُولِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَرَدَّ عِلْمُ مَا اشْتَبَهَ عَلَيْهِ إِلَىٰ عَالِمِهِ. He says that the as you can say now, there is no one who is safe in his deen, in his religion, except him who submits and to Allah Azza wa Jal and to Rasul and to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he returns the knowledge of that which is doubtful to him to the one who knows it, who is meaning to Allah Ta'ala Himself. So we do not know how the sifat of Allah are. We don't know how, when Allah says that Allah has a waj and a, which is translated as a face, or a yad which is translated as a hand, or that or let's say for instance that Allah laughs or smiles at the various translations of the hadith goes, and all these various other sifat of Allah mentioned in the Quran, in the hadith, this, all of this is, as you can say, doubtful things that we do not know the reality of it. So we affirm that which Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam has stated, but we don't give it our personal interpretation, and we say it is like this or like that and this and all these sort of things here, nor do we go as other people go to the other extreme where they start making that, for example, Allah says He has let's say for instance a foot, and then people, and a yad which is a hand, and waj which is a face. Now people start putting this together, making their own conglomeration, and then start assuming that Allah has a body and a form and a shape, and also sits on a chair and all these sort of things. This is now the other extreme. So us as Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we don't go into any of this. We leave the knowledge of this. He says, وَرَدَّ عِلْمُ مَشْتَبَهَ عَلَيْهِ إِلَىٰ عَالِمِهِ. We leave all this knowledge which we do not know to the one who knows it, who is Allah Ta'ala Himself. So on that point, inshallah, we can stop over here, and next time we can continue on from here again. So this is on page 6 of this particular print, and we finished point number 35. Inshallah, next time we can continue from point number 36. So next, as I always mention, every second Monday we do Aqeedah. So one Monday we do Aqeedah, and the next Monday we do Al-Shama'il al-Muhammadiyya, better known as Al-Shama'il al-Tirmidhi. So we have done the Aqeedah this week. So next week Monday we will do Al-Shama'il al-Muhammadiyya as continuing on as normal, and the week thereafter we will come back to the Aqeedah and continue on from this point here. So until then, we end here and we say, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.